TV. Today what we're going to be doing is beginning chapter one of our three-part series all about standardized testing for college. So we're talking PSAT, SAT, ACT, and even SAT subject tests. So you're definitely going to want to stay tuned for this really important information. But before we jump right in, I just want to introduce myself. If you do not know, my name is Mackenzie Warren. I'm the founder of Max School Prep, and I am wholeheartedly dedicated and invested in your success so that you can make sure that you're excelling throughout your high school career and in an academic setting in general. Now, so far, if you're liking what you're hearing, I just want to encourage you to give this video a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and also hit the notification bell so that you don't miss a beat. And on that note, no more stalling. It's time, let's get it. Alrighty, so just a little while ago, I mentioned four huge tests. We got the PSAT, the SAT, the ACT, and also SAT subject tests. So the first question that probably popped into your head are, what the heck are those tests, Mackenzie, and why even are they important? Two questions that you're going to be getting the answer to in today's video. What I want to do first is start with the SAT and the ACT. Those are standardized entrance exams that pretty much, for the most part, cover the same educational topics. And what they were designed to do is measure a student's preparedness and readiness for college. For this reason, a student's performance on one or both of these exams is often factored into major decisions made by college admissions panels and merit-based scholarship review committees. Now, while I did say that the SAT and the ACT are generally assessing students over the same material, you should know that the SAT, as well as the PSAT, is completely owned and created by the College Board, while the ACT, on the other hand, is developed and administered by ACT Incorporated. Now, something else that I want to let you know is that because it's no secret that some students can have inflated GPAs and inflated grades depending on the high school that they're coming from, the SAT and the ACT are tools used by colleges and scholarship organizations to cross-compare students from an academic standpoint because the SAT and the ACT really level the playing field. Now, since I brought up the PSAT earlier, I want to get into the nitty-gritty of what that test is all about. In short, the PSAT, also known as the preliminary SAT, is a nationwide exam that basically serves as a practice version of the actual SAT. So what's really great about the PSAT is that by taking it, students really get the opportunity to enhance their skills when it comes to test taking for the SAT, and they also get to gain familiarity with what they can expect the SAT to be like in terms of timing, structure, format, all that good stuff. Now, just so you know, the College Board offers the PSAT 8-9 to 8th graders and 9th graders. The PSAT 10 was designed for high school sophomores. And finally, the PSAT NMSQT, also known as the PSAT National Merit Scholarship Qualifying Test, which is certainly a mouthful, was created by the College Board with high school juniors in mind, even though sophomores may take the test. Now, the last test I want to touch on is the SAT 2 or SAT subject test, which are just some more brain children of the College Board, like the PSAT and the SAT. Each SAT subject test focuses on a specific discipline under one of the five broad overarching categories of English, math, history, science, or foreign languages. And because SAT subject test scores also put students on an equal playing field when it comes to academics, they are yet another factor used by colleges to cross-compare applicants from different high schools and different educational backgrounds, to make judgments on a student's readiness and preparedness for the college curriculum, and to also make placement decisions about which college courses a student might be exempt from. So with all of that said, because I know I've given you a lot of information thus far, I want to switch gears a little bit to discuss, why are these standardized tests even important, and what are the perks of doing well on them? Alrighty, so the first thing I have for you is that at the end of the day, you really don't have to take both the SAT and the ACT because many colleges, even the highly selective ones, only require that you report your scores on one exam. Obviously the one that you perform the best on. But you should know that it is highly recommended that you take both exams because the bottom line is you might click more with one test over the other. For example, even though I made a 1540 on the SAT, I'll always regret not knowing what I could have made on the ACT because I chose to only dedicate myself to studying and preparing for all things SAT. And the suckiest part of it all is that a lot of my high school friends perform significantly better on the ACT than they did on the SAT. But regardless of what test score you decide to report report to colleges, it's super important that you perform to the best of your ability on both tests, because I'm gonna be honest with you, the higher your SAT or ACT test score is and the higher your national percentile is, the more doors that will be open to you in terms of colleges and merit-based scholarships. So in other words, a high test score makes you an even more competitive applicant, which is why you definitely need to take the test seriously, because they 100% matter. Now, moving on just a little bit, I wanna say that while performing to the best of your ability on the PSAT 8, 9, and the PSAT 10 will give you an accurate idea of your strong suits and the areas you need to improve on when it comes to the actual SAT, the PSAT and MSQT, on the other hand, is the literal money maker. And what I mean by that is that of all the PSAT types, the PSAT and MSQT is the one that matters the most, because if you earn a super high score on it as a junior, you could qualify to receive a national merit scholarship, which could be used towards paying for your college tuition, which sounds like a pretty good deal if you ask me. Now, I do just want to throw it out there that I did mention earlier that sophomores can take the PSAT and MSQT. But no matter how high a sophomore student may score on the PSAT and MSQT, they unfortunately, as a 10th grader, are not eligible for national merit, which sucks, but it is what it is, and I want you to be aware of it. Now, with all of this talk of PSAT and MSQT and national merit scholarship, you're probably wondering, well, okay, Mackenzie, how high exactly do I need to perform on the PSAT and MSQT to qualify for the national merit scholarship? To answer that question, in order to be considered for the national merit scholarship, you'll generally need a PSAT and MSQT score that's within the top 1% of scores in your specific state, meaning that the exact cutoff score you'll need to meet differs across every state and also changes from year to year. Now, regarding SAT subject tests, I'm gonna be honest with you, not every college requires that you report your scores on them, but to cover your bases, it is recommended that you take about 2 to 3 SAT subject tests over the course of your high school career. And kind of like I've been saying all along, performing well on SAT subject tests, getting a high score on them, and having a national percentile that's higher than 90 will allow you to look even more competitive to colleges and will also make you more of a hot commodity, plain and simple. Moreover, the better you perform on the SAT subject test that you decide to take, the higher the likelihood that you'll be eligible to place out of introductory college courses that won't serve to stimulate you and that won't serve to challenge you. And on that note, because I've given you quite a bit of information to juggle and process in your mind, we're gonna go ahead and put a temporary pin in this 3-part series on standardized testing for colleges. But don't you worry, we'll definitely be picking up right where we left off in the next video. However, before you go, I wanna give you a reminder now to give this video a thumbs up if you didn't do it at the beginning, subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and also hit the notification bell so that you can stay in the loop. And I'll be sure to see you for part 2 of this 3-part series in the next video. Bye!